car, you've seen one of these vehicles, Pow Laboratories, delivering and picking up someplace in southern Ontario. Right now, we're going to take a tour inside Pow Laboratories to learn what this family-owned business is making here in Woodstock. We're here with Chris Pow. And Chris, this is a family-owned business, correct?
Yes, that's right.
So how long has your family been in the, what do you call it, denture business?
Well, we're a full-service dental laboratory. We perform dental technology for the dentists and denturists. We've been in business since 1930. It was started by my papa, who was from the Lake Erie area, and moved to Woodstock. I think he grew up on a farm. And someone had suggested, he must have been talking to a dentist, that said maybe you might want to think, at the time it was called a dental mechanic.
Mm-hmm.
And so he set up in Woodstock with a dentist, and that's how it came to be in Woodstock.
And so you joined the firm when?
I joined in 2002, so that's about 10, 11 years ago now, and it's been a lot of fun. I've enjoyed it. My background is engineering and business, so I don't necessarily get involved in the manufacturing process, but it's certainly been exciting to oversee the business.
So when he started, it was relatively simple, but now it's pretty high tech, wouldn't you say?
Things have changed significantly in the last 7 or 8 years. The advent of CAD/CAM manufacturing has made a big difference. Prior to that, it was a lot of what we call the lost wax technique, where you do the design in wax by hand and then you create a mold. Whereas now, for many of our products, not all of them, but many, we design it on computer stations and mill it or print it with 3D printers. So it really has changed the face of our business.
What kinds of products do you actually manufacture here? Do you want to show us some?
Yeah, we have three product lines, essentially. We have what we call removables. So those are prostheses that you can take out. The patient can take them out at night before they go to bed, and so on. We have we also do orthodontics, so that would be retainers and so on. We work for orthodontics and GPs as well that do those procedures. And we also do fixed work and implant work, which is fixed work is something that the dentist cements in your mouth and it stays there.
Yeah?
Yeah.
But there's also new kinds of teeth replacements. Is that the right word? Do we call it replacing your teeth?
We have new materials, certainly, over the last number of years. Traditionally, crowns were made from gold.
Mm.
They still are, in porcelain. But with the high price of gold over the last while, there have been new materials that have sort of replaced them. And they're very aesthetic and very good. Zirconia has been very popular. It makes up about 40% of what we do now.
Really?
for the crowns.
So, do you have an example here? What some of those changes look
like?
Well,
this right here is a zirconia bridge. It used to be before, and we still make a lot of these. This would be gold in here,
mm-hmm.
the substructure, with porcelain built on top, and now it's either all zirconia or zirconia with porcelain built up. The porcelain gives it a real lifelike look and enhances the aesthetics.
Sure does. But this is not the only kind that you have, is it?
No, it's not. We've got right here, for example, this would be the gold. This is a white gold, so that's the substructure there.
Mm-hmm.
And then the porcelain's built on top. And different shades, everyone's different.
Try and match it for your mouth?
Trying to match the shade of the patient's natural dentition is often a challenge, for sure.
And these?
Again, these are just other examples of single crowns. That mm-hmm. one is based on gold, and this one as well. That's mm-hmm. a central.
Are we going to get a chance to see, check out the back room, to see the high-tech wizardry that you folks are involved in? There's more innovation coming up right after these messages. So you do custom shading. Is it very hard for you to match someone's existing teeth?
It can be quite difficult.
Huh?
The most challenging case for us would be just a single tooth anterior and the front,
mm-hmm.
With two natural teeth adjacent. That's the most difficult one. And so often the dentist will send their patient over here so that our ceramist, the person who's actually going to be building up the porcelain, can take the shade and use some of our technology here to make sure that there's a good match.
Okay, I guess that's important.
Yes.
Yeah.
Is this how you match?
Yeah. So these are this is an example of what they call shade tabs. So the ceramist, when they're here with the patient, would hold these up in front of the patient's mouth. And this is all color corrected. We've got these lights are 6,500 Kelvin lights. There's the paint and so on. We've north facing so that we're trying to get an ideal situation here for picking the shade. So the ceramists and our RDTs will go through and ensure that this is going to be the one that fits, because I'm sure you've seen it sometimes. If you meet someone, you can tell when their central tooth is.
No, without looking at my teeth. Do teeth naturally age? Are we looking at an aging process? Somebody starts with this and ends up with that?
Yeah, for sure that's part of it. And also some people, if they're getting more than just their, from an aesthetic standpoint of view, if they're getting veneers done and so on, they might, and it's going to be the majority of the teeth in their mouth that are seen when you smile, they might go with a lighter shade, or if they've been bleaching, mm-hmm. to match what they've been bleaching to.
Really?
Yeah. So it gives
this takes the shade of my teeth?
So you hold it up, there's a sterilized end that goes on here, and you hold it up to your mouth, the ceramist clicks the button, and it gives an indication of what the shade might be. And for us, we still use our eye. The eye is still probably the most accurate. But this helps maybe with a starting point, or even to verify that if this agrees with the ceramist, then
I think that's cool.
Yeah, this is cool. This is a lot more compact than it used to be. This is a few generations ago they were quite a bit bigger, but this is what we've been using now.
Amazing. So Chris, what is the thing you first receive from a dentist? Where does that business start?
Okay, what we receive from the dentist is typically would be an impression of the patient's mouth. Depending on what phase of the process we're at. Here, for example, this is a crown and bridge impression that we would have received. You can see that's the tooth that's been prepped.
Mm-hmm.
And these are the adjacent teeth. So this is a single crown that will be being fabricated for this patient. And this also gives us the opposing arch, so that when we're making the crown.
Opposing means the top versus the bottom.
Yeah, the top versus the bottom. so that we know how the teeth interdigitate, basically, how the teeth go together like this, so that when the patient bites down, it feels natural. It's not high in their mouth,
right?
And so on.
The mouth is very sensitive, wouldn't you say?
It's very complicated. Everything we do is a custom, even though our products are, we make dentures and crown and bridge and retainers. Everyone's mouth is unique,
yeah.
So every case is basically a custom case.
Wow,
which makes it pretty challenging.
And that contributes to the expense of it. I mean, it's made one off every time.
Yes, exactly. Even though we've got some automated processes, it's a unique, everyone's mouth's different, right?
So Chris, now that you've got that impression, you're gonna send it where?
Well, we'll pour up the model in plaster, so that, because for the CAD/CAM designing process, we need to digitize the model.
And use a scanner?
Yes, we use a scanner.
Yep. Let's take us through the scanner.
Over here. Here's the scanner. This is a three-shape scanner.
What does that mean, three-shape?
It's just a manufacturer. And it's developed in Denmark, in Copenhagen. This company got its start making hearing aids. And being a little bit similar to what we do with a dental impression, that when you have a hearing aid, they take an impression of your inner ear.
Make sure it's unique.
Because it's unique, yeah. So they've branched out into dental, and they're, I would say, the leaders right now in the world with this technology. We've had this for a few years. It's working great.
So here, let's say that you would have gotten in here is a look at this is the scanned result of what we previously saw.
Yeah, that's a scan, not of that case, but of a model.
Yeah.
And this was, so the, you put that, there's the model in there. You scan it, and it takes about 5 minutes to scan it. And the technician who works here would tweak it a bit, clean it up, make sure that the scan's clean, and then it gets saved over onto our server, where someone on a design station then picks it up and would design the case.
Now you put it on the server, does that mean that the any impression that I had would be saved here and you could replicate it?
Yeah.
I could have teeth for life.
Yeah, we could pull this up years down the road and it would be there.
It would make me prettier?
Yeah.
I doubt it.
Maybe.
So Chris, after your scan work is completed, where does it go then?
It goes over to the design stations where the technicians will then design the case.
And we're in design area now.
This is where we have our design stations, and most behind us are the ceramists that are building up the porcelain.
It's an art form, isn't it?
Oh, very much so.
Yeah. But you have a high degree of technology. So
So this Anna's working. This is one of the design stations here.
Mm-hmm.
This is the three-shaped system. We've got other systems as well, but this is primarily the one that we use.
Chris, what are we seeing now?
Tara's designing a chrome partial here. So that's a partial framework that fits in the patient's mouth. It's supported with a substructure of chrome, and then we'll put acrylic and teeth on top. This has been scanned similar to what we saw over there,
mm-hmm.
and it comes over to Tara's station here, and she'll do all the designing of it.
So what she's wiping away here?
And this is
there's
some block over, it's called virtual wax. And this is called a haptic device right here that she's using, and she can actually feel pressure and the contours through that device. And this is the one that was developed by MIT originally for the medical devices and so on, and it's now in dental. We've had this for about 5 years, and we're the second lab in Canada to get it, and it's been wonderful. And it's very accurate because there's a few, by designing this way, there are a few steps in the process that eliminate errors that of contraction and expansion. So it's a wonderful fit. They're very accurate doing it this way.
So even though it's on the screen, she can still feel what she's doing.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah, yeah.
As you can see here at Pow Laboratories, it's a very complicated, very high-tech operation. And of course, what we're going to see now is a 3D printer, something you've probably already heard about. But this 3D printer lays down a material, 1 micron, very tiny bits at a time, and takes many hours to complete. Why do you have 2 of these printers?
We have 2 of these in part because of the capacity, the volume that we do. And then also, if one of these were to go down, we're not going to let down our customers, so we can continue to print on the other one. And these are very sensitive. This room here is self-contained. The air conditioner doesn't pull air from anywhere else, just in here, and it needs to be a certain temperature. When we first bought these, we had them out in the lab, a little bit dustier, and we ran into problems. So we've got them in here now, and touch wood, they seem to be working well. So this is sort of what it looks like when it's done. I set these up. It takes about 8 hours to run a
sample. Really?
And I've paused this one, and you can see it's in the middle of the process where there's a couple of frameworks there. What happens is it builds up paraffin wax, which is a kind of a brittle, melts at a low temperature sort of wax. And the green part is a light cured resin, and that's actually the prosthetic part of the what's being produced here.
And we've heard about these printers a lot. What are they working from?
Well, they're working from an STL file,
which is the
computer file that all these systems use to talk to each other. It's open architecture, so it doesn't matter what manufacturer you bought it from. The STL file should work.
Mm-hmm.
Some manufacturers close it up a bit. However, we're trying to keep open as much as we can.
To maintain flexibility.
Yeah, so we're not tied into one system. So this right here, it's based on the STL file. It builds it up. It's like microns at a time. It takes about 8 hours to build up. It depends on the height of what we're producing. And it will, in 8 hours, be done. It's a light cure process. Like I said, microns at a time. This tray just slides back and forth.
A micron is 1/1000th of a millimeter?
Yes.
We're going to be right back with more innovation. What's going on here?
This is milling zirconia. This is a roll and milling machine. It's rolling zirconia frameworks, which will then have porcelain layered on top of them.
Now, zirconium is not what we see, after hours selling me cubic zirconium, fake diamonds.
No, it's an all ceramic material. We make zirconia frameworks, and we also do full contour zirconias, which is what's been milled out a few minutes ago.
And again, this is working off a digital image?
It is.
Yeah.
It is. All the information's inputted in here. It takes the necessary tools and builds it to the parameters that we've set out for it.
And why is this called Old Zoe?
Zoe is actually just to keep us in the computer straight. Zoe stands for zirconia, and the new one is Max for wax.
Max for wax.
It is.
So you can do the same process, except this one is using wax.
Yes. This one here has diamond burrs, which are a little bit more
diamond,
accurate.
Diamond what?
Diamond burrs.
Burrs?
Each one of the burrs up here that's milling.
Oh,
we have a series of five burrs, and each of them are made out of a diamond material. The carbides are better for the wax, so we keep the carbides in that side.
This is so high-tech here. What's the competition like in your marketplace?
It's very competitive, just like all businesses. We're a larger lab, and we're able to bring in some of this technology that maybe other labs can't. The average lab would have about 4 or 5 people in it. However, our teams are we're full service. So mm-hmm. our teams are, we offer a wide variety of products that maybe not all labs would do. So that gives us a little bit of our size. But we're still very custom, great customer service and so on. And our systems are there to keep that going strongly.
How many people work here?
There are about 70 of us right
70
now.
70 people. And tell me about the growth over the years. You know, business started small and...
Yeah, well, it's been steady growth. The economy certainly plays a role in what we do here. There's a lot of dentistry is, unless you're, it could be deferred, right? If you don't want to have that cosmetic case done, then you might not if you're worried about maybe your job or whatever might be going on in your life. If you're feeling some of it's more functional and some of those things just need to be done. So we're steady, we're fortunate, and we look forward to the future.
The business climate, I mean, is one of the considerations, but reach, how broadly do you supply your product?
Our primary market is Southern Ontario, and we have 11 delivery cars, and they go every day, most times twice a day, to Kitchener-Waterloo, 100 kilometers radius, basically around the laboratory. We also do a lot of courier work, so up north, as far as, you know, Sudbury, Sault Ste. Marie, and out on the west, or sorry, the east coast, out in Newfoundland and in New Brunswick and so on. We do some work out there as well.
How do you go about getting customers for your product?
The biggest thing in our business is word of mouth. If we do a good job for our clients and our customers, that's how it works. We also have a marketing group and so on internally, and a salesperson that she's out on the road visiting dentists and trying to maintain those relationships and so on.
Yeah. Chris, tell me about where you go to get qualified employees and what you do about it.
Most of our training is done in-house, so we hire people that possibly and usually don't have experience in dental, but with our internal training programs, they work up through the levels, and it takes many years to learn how to do a lot of the things that we do here. There's also George Brown in Toronto has a program for dental technologists where they get what they call their RDT, Registered Dental Technologist status, and then every lab has to have an RDT on staff to check the cases in the lab and check them out before they go to the dentist's office or the denturist's office. But it's a huge thing for us with all our technology and the complexity of what we do. It's a high priority.
Both of us love being in Woodstock, but somebody in Toronto, what are the ways that you go to get folks from Toronto to consider Woodstock as a place of employment?
We're a good employer. If you have a background in dental technology, we offer a lot of, as you've seen, a lot of high-tech stuff, mm-hmm. and a lot of the young grads are certainly interested in that opportunity, because not all labs have this. And we also, through George Brown, we've developed a connection with some of the students and so on, and we've been bringing some of those students on board.
Because they find that they can have a good quality of life here?
They enjoy it, for sure. It's a change of pace, and I think that, combined with the opportunity here, it seems to be a win-win.
One final thing, what's the future look like? What are we going to be seeing in Powell Laboratories 10 years out?
Well, that's a good question. I think more digital work. A lot of what we do digitally now is in the fixed area, but I think as time goes on, the orthodontics and the dentures will also see advancements in digital workflows.
This is just another example of a company that has prospered over the decades by committing themselves to train their staff well, a commitment to technology that you've seen, and basically a desire to deliver the best possible product to their customers. We'll be right back with more innovation. Stay tuned.